It gives me great pleasure now to introduce Benjamin Harshav, who is a professor at Yale University and a great scholar on the work and life of Marc Chagall. And he will speak about Khidekel, Chagall, and Lissitsky.
This is not my first visit at the YIVO. I gave you several lectures on other topics. I am a specialist on the period of Lazar Khidekel, and I, with fascination, I saw how important it was that the family brought all this material to life here. I published four rather big books on Chagall and his art, and I am not going to repeat it here. I would only register that I don't agree with many things that have been said here, especially about Chagall. Isaac Deutscher, a great scholar, a famous scholar, wrote a history of Trotsky, as well as other things about Jews in Eastern Europe. Himself a grandson of the chief rabbi of Krakow. And he said that the whole idea that Hasidism influenced Chagall is nonsense. Chagall didn't know Hebrew, he couldn't read it. He tells in his autobiography that that his father would go at 6 a.m. to the prayer house to say the Kaddish. Why Kaddish? Just in case. And he knew not much about Jewish things. The only ceremony around Hasidism was Erev Shabbat. In the evening before Saturday, mother would force his siblings, there were 9 of them, mother would force on them to sing the rabbi's tune, Nigun, the rabbi's tune, and father would snore in the same place. So that's not much of Hasidism. There is a problem of abstract structures that in much of those things there is a Russian quasi-scientific mysticism. Tsiolkovsky was mentioned here. Tsiolkovsky was really the inventor of the missile. He shot missiles across the bay of Leningrad, and that was based on Fyodorov's theory that the dead people couldn't be dead. They are in the stratosphere, and we have to build missiles to reach them. Khlebnikov had theories that combine chronotopos, that combine space and time in one four-dimensional unit, and had mysticism. We are people, we the futurists are people not who live not in time but in space, and various things like that. I'm not going to get into it, I only wanted to register. I have remarks on 2 points. One is the role of Jews in such coteries, and the second one is some thoughts about Khidekel. I should start with Khidekel. Nobody paid attention to the fact that Khidekel cannot be a name in Jewish families. Who heard about Khidekel? Why Khidekel as a family name? Khidekel appears once in the Bible, actually twice, but once in the Hebrew Bible, as one of the four rivers that go out of paradise. Period. That's all we know. I think that there is a much stronger influence of Jewish movements in Khidekel's time, then people don't know the facts, so what can we do? But Khidekel is the river Euphrates and what? Yeah, that I know. I think that this unusual name and other facts that Chashnik collected show that he was involved, but he was scared. He was scared all his life. Khan Mogametov showed us, told about his visits with Khidekel. At the time of his growth, he mysteriously was 14 years old when he joined the students of Chagall and later Malevich, and against Chagall. I try to condense it. If you read the biography of Khidekel, you will see that there is, that he talks about Borokhov and about Peretz. Yehuda Leib Peretz had in his name a club in Vitebsk, and those were the Bundists. And on the other side were Ber Borokhov, the major theoretician of Marxist Zionism. And you cannot say Unovis found a place in the Borokhov house. How did it found a place? Very simple. When you see the pictures, Chagall's class had 9 students, and they were all Jews, with no exception. And one I suspected, Svetin, but he is Yaakov Moiseyevich. Moiseyevich is the son of Moses. It cannot be a non-Jewish name. So it's deeper than it's presented. And at that same time, there was a song, Bein Nahar Prat Unhar Khidekel. Are there any Israelis who can sing? Sing it for us. But you see, there's such a popular song that survived from, Bialik wrote it from 1909 to this day. People sing it, and always they say in the second line, they say ta-ta-la-la. But the word Khidekel is engraved in that. This is basically what I wanted to say about Khidekel's name. But somebody has to find Khidekel's father. Why did father give him such a name? There couldn't be an inherited Russian Jewish name, Khidekel, that is only imposed by modern, not Orthodox, modern, secular, Haskalah person who was Khidekel's father. Okay. I'm not a scholar of this, and I'm glad if you discover it. I only want to say this is a very strange name. No, for Jewish names, it is very strange. Okay. But I do think that it... I'm happy to hear that. But still you have to explain it. You cannot discuss Lazar without his background. Okay. You see, I said I will make a few remarks. I have a few slides to show too. Let me go on. So that was my first remark, that Khidekel is a very strange name, even if there are 500 Khidekels. Let me finish talking, and then we'll discuss it outside. The fact that in the group of Chagall's class, all of them were Jews, calls our attention to the role of Jews in general culture in the 20th century especially. The question is, A, they are not Jews in any religious sense. They are Jews who wanted to escape from the Jewish ghetto and came to the modern culture, to the new culture, and looked around. There is a Jew on the left and a Jew on the right. So the question is, what does their Jewishness mean? It means that that I'm afraid to say that it is a racial response. Those are individuals who are very strong on individualism because they escaped from the fold of the community. They escaped as individuals. When they came there, it turns out that they are among Jews in that sense. The last word we can say is that they are Jews who are people descending from religious Jews. Look what happens. The group of Chagall understood the problem. Chagall invited to Vitebsk only Goyim except for Lissitsky. Boguslavskaya, Puni, Malevich, only non-Jews, because all the students were Jews. But if you put a pin through the globe and you come from Chagall's Vitebsk, you get to New York, there is a new school of art, minimalists, and the minimalists in the list, famous list of the 10 are, in the list of 10 there is not one that is not a Jew. And the first 20 students of Freud were not Jews. That is, were Jewish. By this strangely racist description. How can we explain it? We can explain sociologically that there were no opportunities for Jews before. Now there are opportunities. The opportunities were created by the Jews themselves. But it was a place for expansion of fields of knowledge and sciences, and in that place the Jews built their response that is not only intellectual, that is also filmmakers, right? Hollywood. It would be, so far we could say, okay, Jews are abstract people, they are not connected to concrete events, to concrete people, they are abstractionists, and therefore they are theoretical, and therefore there's a Jewish influence. Fine, but why should all of them, is there no place, did the Jews prevent anybody from joining the psychoanalysis or the suprematism? It is clearly that the non-Jews, I am careful how to say it, the non-Jews were not interested in getting into Jewish groups. You see it time and again, as I said, suprematists, Freud, Hollywood. Time and again, when they build something new, they build it not for us, not for the Jews. They build it for the sake of science, of knowledge, of advancement, of art. But the result was that they are accused of being, or praised for being, Jewish new field. I think you understand the gist of the matter. As to Chagall, I have a very well documented book that you can read and we can discuss it. I am glad that you say that there are many Khidekels. I would like to see, it's not easy to find, but one can find in archives the Khidekels from 500 years ago. In any case, that's one thing about the Khidekels. I move from generalizations of sociology to generalizations of art. I see the 20th century as a century of avant-garde and revolution and upheaval and canceling the old system. But when you look carefully, you see that each such shift in the system, each such shift in the system has four stages. It is not suprematism when you define it and you place it in history. The five stages are evolution, I'll explain later, evolution, revolution, degree zero, construction, integration. The first should be number two, the revolution. A revolution occurs with drastic means, or a new group of people appears. I forgot the Russian formalists. Russian formalists, only one of them was not a Jew, and his name is Tomaszewski, which is but he's not a Jew. All Russian formalists who influenced the theory of literature in the 20th century were Jews. They didn't want to say that they are Jews, but they got established. Eichenbaum told the world that his grandfather was a Hebrew poet. But otherwise, they didn't boast with their Jewishness. Nevertheless, they were. Eichenbaum's grandfather was a poet who wrote a very ambitious long poem, Ishkoki. Ishkoki, in his Hebrew, is chess. You can find in Talmud such words. So the first thing that strikes you is revolution. There is a revolution, there is an upheaval. Art cannot go on as it was before. That is clear to everybody. But whenever it's established that there was a revolution in some field, then we think that actually there were precedents, there were previous cases of art or of urbanistic culture or whatever, of utopia. There were previous cases, but consolidated, they came in a revolution. After revolution, there are small pieces. If you know Lissitsky's work, there is a story of two squares, a red square and a black square. And the red square splinters the black square. It destroys it. And so and then you need a new beginning. And this is degree zero. In linguistics, there is such a term that is when there are two kinds of degree zero. One is Malevich, suprematism. And the second is Dada, futurism. So there is this neat, pure, clean square, black square on a white canvas. But there is also the noise and the garbage that Dada is collected. Eventually, we could say, and yes, after degree zero, after the elements have been clarified, the elements in squares in the suprematism and the elements in Dada and Zaunyazyk, it's called the future translogical language. After we have the elements, we need to combine them together. And you see in the 20th century a strong movement, for example, the surrealism, in French surrealism, One sentence doesn't make sense in the next sentence. They are disjointed, crazy metaphors, very impressive. But the move was to consolidate it, that is to call it a construct, and you have psychoanalysis to help the surrealists to unify all those splinters of the mind. And so you have the Bauhaus, and you have the Gestalt psychology, and you have various efforts to unify. I call the last one integration, because eventually there comes a movement from the critics, from the readers, to integrate with our constructs with some framework, some context of ideology or some context of history. So in that perspective, the difference between Lazar and Lissitsky is different from the difference between Lazar and Chagall. I could talk about two strains. I'll finish soon. I could talk about two strains. One is the response to the situation, a response to the revolution in formal terms, and one is in representational terms. Lazar almost imitated Lissitsky. He admired Lissitsky. Lissitsky influenced him. Lissitsky was older than him by 4 years or something like that. And that was the road from Malevich to Chagall. I don't understand. Malevich was a very hard, difficult person, so was Chagall. But Malevich made a white square on a white canvas. Where do you go from there? You reduced everything to the minimal of representation. And Chagall made a revolt against that. And the greatness of Chagall lies, I think, in combining in each painting, in combining the formal and the representational. But the representational is deformed. Deformation is a slogan for him. I have a representation of a cow or of a person, but the representation is deformed. Deformation is the slogan. Whereas in Malevich and his students, I don't see the point today as a historical fascination, great. But beyond that, we cannot close the door to representation, or call it differently, call it whatever. I think that those are the main points I wanted to say. And if you have the slides. I don't know, someone has to help me with that.
I have it. I can change your
slide. You have it? Yeah, but I don't know who the order. Oh. Remember, maybe you remember that in somebody's presentation, maybe in Regina's, there was the building of the school where Chagall built his college for art, for studies of art. Yeah. You see, he makes a cubist painting. I can't talk for me. He makes a cubist painting. It's called Cubist Landscape. To show that it's almost like a painting by Malevich. To show, I can also do that. Picasso, Malevich, I can do that. But in a little corner, in the entrance to the building, the entrance that you have in your photo, in the same entrance, a little Chagall walks with an umbrella. And in between the whole balagan of geometrical forms, he puts himself in. And the umbrella is very important in Chagall, because in Yiddish we say, Zorem Gott Bashirem Zayn. Let God umbrella him, that is, cover him with an umbrella. So he flies from the Eiffel Tower down to Paris with on his parachute. There were no parachutes, yes, before Chagall invented them. And you see here, do you see the little figure? Okay, there are more details interesting here, but we'll talk about it another time. Yeah, go ahead. Oh, this is called Homage to Apollinaire, but has nothing to do. Apollinaire was a French poet and critic who promoted Chagall. When Chagall was 14 years old, he had a one-man show from Paris. They took him to Berlin. Wild man didn't wash and talked Russian with a Yiddish accent and didn't know any other language. But he was, the readers were fascinated. This is actually Adam and Eve. It's called Chagall because he painted it in 1911. Apollinaire and Sandrart, his good friends, came to Paris in 1912. So he had a little space, so he devoted it to four modernists, the avant-garde poets, Sandrart, Walden, Apollinaire, and Canudo. Look what happens here. This is Adam and Eve, actually. It's Adam and Eve, deformed. It looks like a Renaissance painting by Masaccio, where you have men and women exiled from the paradise, whereas here, men and women are merged, and we don't know, did women come out of men's ribs, or men came out of women's rib? You see, they are merged sexually, and there is a competition in the whole painting between what decides, geometrical figures or representational figures. Geometrical figures look at his legs. In real life, you cannot reduce a leg to a string. But here, the pelvis, he starts with a half ball, a geometrical figure, and it becomes a pelvis. And he, of course, he hides the genital place, and as always, he hides it and promotes it, shows it, calls our attention to the fact that there is a genital thing here. The story is his mother came into his studio in Vitebsk and told and saw a naked woman on a painting, and she said, "Fair, at least cover up her belly." So he covered the belly. But this is in another painting, but it's the same idea. He covered the belly by this promoting more the non-belly, what is lower than the belly. And here too, the hand wants to modestly cover up the genitals, but the result is that it calls our attention to it. Go to another one. You see, in the previous one, in Adam and Eve, we saw a competition of form and representation. Here is a competition of color and representation. You see on top, this is a wedding. On top you see separations as you do in color printing. Entirely abstract, as Gottlieb did in the 60s in New York. But in between this abstract and the floor abstract, which has a very bad very bad, what is it? Reproduction. In this wedding production, you see the world is a stage. The wedding goes around the stage. The floor has segments of a circle, yellow, blue, green, red, all this is abstract, and then he represents the people, and then his mother in the yellow dress, of course, inviting them all to her little store, and little store, Lavka, The real word in Russian is lavka with a V, but he wants to show that this is primitive, that this is folksy language. Go on. I'm just indicating where to look for it. These are the two squares. Where do you go from there? The idea of suprematism is that a painting should not represent any particular place, any particular feeling, but a painting should be black square on a white background that is where was I now? Well, the suprematism for Malevich is feeling, not a specific feeling for something, but feeling as a totality. He called his art objectless art, and there was a movement of objectless art, badly translated into English as non-objective art. And it's not non-objective, it means without the object. We don't need objects, we can have a general feeling of feeling. But where do you go from there? So Lazar went a little bit in that direction, but he broke with it together with Lissitsky. And Lazar admitted that Lissitsky influenced him. He was his teacher. But that they together found a way out of the impasse, I think, of Malevich. And that is that they decided to study architecture. And I don't know if Lazar, you will say that it's a well-known name, maybe, but it's strange that both of them are Lazar. Only the first name takes the first syllable in Eliezer. The name is Eliezer, but Lissitsky took El Eliezer, El Lazar. And what is his name? Yes. So is that true? But you know what Markovich means? No. But in Jewish concepts, name giving, Mark is the most widespread cover up for Moshe. Mordech too, but that was later done. No. Mordech is later done by the Russians. Marc Antokolsky, Marc Chagall, Marc everywhere there is a Marc, and that is instead of Moshe, if you want, elegant. But Marc is a cover-up, is a euphemism. What else? Yeah, show us more pictures. Can we see? This is the story of two. That is another thing. How do you escape suprematism? You can escape by moving out of the field, either in space or in time. In space, Lissitsky and Khidekel simply made more slabs, more geometrical figures than Malevich allowed. And to have a system of such, they made a system, they went to study architecture. That was a brilliant move, because in the Soviet Union, they wouldn't survive one day for their formalism. But the First World War devastated the country. They needed architects, they needed a building. So they tortured him, but they didn't kill him because they needed architects. Here comes the utopia that you mentioned before, that architects, you have from suprematists in an extension into space, and utopia is an extension into time. Interrupt the sentence, let's go here. Go on. You see, you have dynamism in an object that is totally static. The dynamism will go on. You see? Klinam, Krasnim, Bielich. Alliterations with a white wedge, with a red wedge, kill the blacks, the enemies, the fascists. Go on. You see, Lissitsky brings in an element of movement and of war, of narrative. Go on. This is a symbol of Unovis. I must say, I'm sorry to be iconoclastic, but that is, they always write in mysterious tones, a big found, big philosophy, 5 volumes of Malevich I have to read in order to see a nonsense philosophy. No relation to any philosophy, either metaphysical or analytical. But they make a worship of, it's remarkable as a revolutionary moment in the history of art. But it's not, but I wanted, sorry, I forgot a moment. If you push a pin in the place in the globe where the 9 Jews of Marc Chagall appear, on the other side, you find the 10 that are like, what is it, Mark Rothko. The explanation is the same. The Jews are, it's comfortable for them to be in an abstract atmosphere that is not national, that is not historical, that is an abstract. Go on. Yeah, go on.